Let's just jump right into it. Let's go to the book of Ephesians, again, where we have been kind of stepping off from. If you've missed the last few weeks, I really encourage you to get on online, and we're having a few. Are we on back on target, Richard? Or okay, we've had some. We had somebody hack into our website. Hallelujah, we're important enough for somebody to take a shot at us. I don't. You know, I find it, you know, when I first heard that there's viruses in computers, I go, you know, okay, I understand viruses in the natural world, but, you know, at first, I mean, I was really ignorant. I just said, who creates a virus, I mean, for a computer world? And, of course, it's somebody. Some person has to develop a virus to attack your computer. And I find it just so amazing. Life's so much more fun walking in righteousness. Life's so much more relaxed loving one another, you know. And I could get real upset about it and say we're going to, you know, really whack those guys when Jesus comes back, which we will. But patience right now. I'm real patient. God wants everybody in, including virus makers. But anyway, weird things to me. All right, Ephesians, the third chapter. I'm going to start reading from verse 14, just a prayer of Paul's. And he says, for this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I won't stop too long here, but it is important to know you don't meet anybody that didn't get their name originally from the Father. In other words, their whole existence came because of God. So before you disrespect anybody, no matter what they do, no matter how they act, no matter what they've done, remember this, that they came from the Father, and the Father's trying to get them back. And joined hands with the Father. Satan wants to accuse them. Satan wants to defeat them. Satan wants to keep on putting a ring in their nose and take them down farther. So don't join him by adding to that on judging and criticizing people. Just know that everybody you meet, God, they came from God. Verse 16, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend, and we talked about that word comprehend, and may be able to get a hold of for yourself, with all the saints, what is the breadth, the length, and the height, and the depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up with the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus for all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Man, I tell you, I love this stuff. We talked about getting out into the depths, and that word deep means to get away from the shallow waters and get into the depths. And it's talking about the unfathomable riches, Paul talks about, of Christ Jesus. Now, I got to ask you, what does that look like to you? What's a person look like that is in the depths of God's love? What does a person look like that is experiencing, comprehending for themselves the length, the height, the width, and the depth of Christ's love? You know, Rick was talking about a moment when you're experiencing some of that stuff and your body literally feels like it's going to explode or you're going to just depart from it. There's moments where I literally thought I was just going to, that I was coming out of this body because the heart was starting to have such a capacity to experience God that it could not be contained in my own body. There's times I really thought I was out of here. And there's times that, that it scared me a little bit. And then there's other times I just long for it. What does it feel like? You know, we were talking the other day about just I won't get into all of it, but just, drinking alcohol, taking drugs. There's some new drugs out there that are extremely dangerous right now that our teenagers are experimenting with that are accessible legally and until they get them off the market or whatever else, and just the damage it does is just absolutely incredible. One time can take you and put you into a zombie for the rest of your life right now. There's a reason why we need to keep praying. But I was just, you know, we were talking about that, and you know, how some just like the flavor, and some just like, and some like the buzz, and some like the feeling. And I gotta admit, I'm a guy, I like feeling. I don't know if I'd say I like the buzz, but I suppose that would be the right terminology. I like the buzz. I like to feel. Man, I love to feel. I love to laugh, belly laugh. It doesn't seem like it happens much anymore. But I love I love to, you know me, I love to shout. I love to get excited. I love it. I love to feel. I think life without feeling is gray. It's like when I went to the communist countries the first time and got into Ukraine and got into Poland and got into East Germany. It was just like we went just downhill. East Germany had some life in it because West Germany was pumping so much energy into it. But soon we got into Poland, man, things just got grayer and duller. And I mean, from the bathrooms to the buildings to everything. And then we got into Ukraine and it's just blah. Man, there was no color anywhere. No street signs. No landmarks that mean anything because everything was the same color. No paint. Just I'm telling you, that's like a bad movie, you know. And yet everybody's just existing, and people go through life sometimes just trying to fill out the right form and doing the right things, you know, and just going through the process until they die and never get to feel life. You know, I got to appreciate some of the guys that get in trouble on the golf course because they get excited and yell, and everybody, It's not too bad on our golf course. You can kind of get by with some stuff. But, man, the first time I went to a tennis match, you know, for Chase, and yeah, and everybody looked at me like, well, we don't shout it. No, we don't shout. We don't say nothing. Oh, it's like, this is a bad sport. You know, that just doesn't make any sense, does it? You know, to win and sit there, I won. Nobody say nothing. Okay. I don't know, man. I was created to feel things, and so are you. So to get out into the depths of love means you get out into that deep water where you feel His love. You comprehend it. You actually experience it. You actually know Him. And for a lot of people, it's like they don't know what that looks like. They don't know what that feels like. God to them has been some sort of a religious thing that they have to do to fill out the form to make sure they go to the right place and try to gain His favor. But they don't know Him. They wouldn't know Him if He walked through the door. And I determined as a young person, whatever is going to cost me, I was going to pay the price to know Him. If the Bible says that you can know Him, I'm going to know Him. I don't care how long it takes me. I don't care what pain I go through. And it cost me some things. Early on, it cost me some titles. I was a little bit weird. It cost me friends. It cost me sometimes relationships. It cost me many things, but I'm telling you, life without God just doesn't make any sense. But I've experienced it for so long now that I don't really know what a person looking at it for the first time would be looking at. Sometimes when I get around newborns, I just want to talk to them because it's like, what are you feeling? What are you experiencing? Because it's been so long. In fact, I don't even recall because from the earliest age of my recollection, I knew about God. And then all the things I've experienced since, I've had so many wonderful experiences, I can't remember them. Every once in a while, one will trip back into me about a time in Vietnam or a time in Burma or a time in that, and the Philippines were just incredible moments. And you know, and one of the things I've done all my life is I've laid on the floor so many times, get boom, just black out in the Holy Ghost and look up. Or just, you know, in a building, and I look up sometimes here, you know, and we worship God, and I look at the ceiling, and when I'm looking this direction, I'm seeing some of the stuff that fell off the ceiling because of moisture. You know, but for the most part, I see a beautiful white ceiling. But there have been places where I've been where I've looked it up like this, and just above my hands were just grass and spiders and cobwebs. Man, I've looked at so many different ceilings, stained glass cathedrals, the churches in Ireland. Man, we worship God in those places, and they had the pipe organs and all the beauty. And yet it's so cold in those places. I came in once, and I said, man, do you guys ever crank up the heat in this place? Or I don't know what I said. And I was, and what they do when you get to Ireland is as soon as you get to the building, they start a fire. So by the time you leave, it's starting to feel warm. No, I didn't really figure that one out either. And it was so cold everywhere we went. But anyway, I said to one about the fifth church we went into, and I said, Are all these churches this cold? And the guy said, well, no, we kind of warm them up a little bit, you know, on Sunday. And my friend Les Dodds, you know, the guy that took me there, he just turned to the guy, the pastor, and he said, he's not talking about the temperature. I'm talking about the heart attitude, man. It was just, you know, we'd go to those churches, and a lot of times it'd be just older women and a couple old crippled guys, and that was it. And, man, we come in there with life, I'm rambling here, but I'm trying to say to you, what does it look like to you to be in the depths of God's love? What does it mean to comprehend for yourself? What does it mean to you, not to me or some for some sermon, but what does it mean to you to comprehend God's love? What does it mean to experience it? What experiences have you had? And I don't live in it all the time, but there's times when I remind myself, and there's times that I have to kind of think about, what does it feel like? Because sometimes it seems like it's been a long time. But I'm telling you, from my experience, and I've experienced it in crowds, but I experienced it mostly by myself as a farm boy, and then as just a man of God, and sometimes on planes, and sometimes in the weirdest places, sometimes in hotels, sometimes just out hiking up in the Bighorns. But just when all of a sudden, you're in the depths of His love, it's like you don't give a care about anything. You don't worry about anything. You're not concerned about anything. You're not craving anything because you're so satisfied. You're so full. You're just swimming in this goodness, this like gooey caramel chocolate or something. I don't know, whatever trips your buttons. But man, there's times when that presence of God is so tangible. Boy, when you're there, you just, it's lovely. And if you've never been there, I'm telling you, fight. Go after it. It's yours to be had. I tell you, you don't have to be in a church service. You don't have to be any special. It's just whenever you will open up and receive this love. But you do have to open up, and you got to receive it, and you got to ask for it, and you got to go for it, and here's the thing, you got to believe. You just got to believe that it's yours. Now, a lot of you, most of you here have experienced that many times, but let me ask you, what would it be like to experience it most of the time? Some of you probably say, I don't know if I could function. I don't know if I could get my work done. You know, I believe, I'm comparing this because the Bible does. The Bible says, do not be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. And to me, it's saying they kind of correlate. Man, when I first got into construction here in Sturgis building houses, there were quite a few of the guys that I really loved and appreciated that crews. But man, they came and they were stoned. I mean, not once in a while, every day. One of the crews that ran most of the heavy equipment for us, you know, they came in with the dozers and the loaders and all that. Those boys smoked pot for breakfast, man. I don't know if they recovered from the night before, but I know they smoked pot for breakfast. And man, and every once in a while you're thinking, man, those guys are running a loader just 3 inches away from me. One mess up and I lose my leg. And I'm a guy that likes being close. You know, I do. I fit real well in the manila and all that because there's only a few inches between the cars all the time. 6 lanes of highway in Manila just going, and little kids about this high walk out there. Don't they, Mike? First time you take somebody there and they see that, they just start screaming in the car. There's a kid out there. Yeah. Who's going to get hurt? Not likely. Maybe. I mean, they die, but not very often. You know why? Because the kids just walk out there, they stop, and the car, and then they take another, and they don't. And the one guy told me, he said, listen. I said, hey, how do you get across to the street? He says, don't run. So whatever you do, that was the first counsel I got. Don't run, because they don't know what to do with somebody that runs. They don't know how to estimate anything because they're just used to everybody walking and just. When we got to Thailand, we jumped on some guys with motorcycles just to go watch a movie, you know, and they really, there's guys that haul you like taxis on motorcycles, but these guys weren't hauling anybody. I mean, they just had their own motorcycles, but we were lost, and we were in a dark place. We were underneath this overhead, you know, pass, and no lights around, and these two guys were over there, and Daniel says, "Hey, let's go ask them for a ride." I go, "Gee, Daniel, we don't know them. They don't have no little taxi light on." But I said, "I'm tired of walking too." We were lost. So we walked over, and somehow they just knew enough English. I think it was maybe just the green dollars that we held out that they understood. I don't know if they understood anything more than that. But we said, "Hey, you guys want to, you know?" And they go, they looked at each other and said, "Well, yeah, sure, okay." And said, "Hop on." So we got on, and the guy in front, Daniel, man, he just took off like a bullet. We told him we were late for the movie. And my guy was already starting to scream because he didn't want to go that fast. But I'm telling you, we were weaving in and out of cars to where, I'm telling you, I was pulling my knees right into his seat. I didn't want to, you know, be too friendly, but I really didn't care because my knees were missing taillights by a quarter of an inch. I mean, I was brushing my leg on taillights at about 40, 50 miles an hour. And I thought, you know, that's going to really hurt if you pop one of them and that leg goes that way. You know, so I'm just like this and I'm like this. And this guy didn't know a lot of English, but we were both, I was going to use the B word, but we were both complaining viciously. I don't mind being close, but what do you do? These guys, like I said, would get stoned and they'd function. But could you function? Could you function as a parent? Could you function as an adult? Could you function at your job site and being intoxicated in God's love? Is it possible? Is it possible? What would it be like to be on the job site and be intoxicated in God's love? Cliff and I once were building a church over in Spearfish, man, those are good days, weren't they, Cliff? Ah, man, those are good days. I'd shut down the lumberyard. I went to work. You know, I was Cliff's pastor. He didn't know what it'd be like hiring a pastor. I didn't know what it'd be like working for a deacon. So we had a blast. But we stopped at a restaurant, got to sharing the Lord with a concrete guy, and ended up staying there 2-3 hours. In the meantime, the lumberyard came and delivered all our materials and put it all on the deck in the center. And we hadn't had all the supports underneath the floor yet. And we expected them to put it around the perimeter, okay? But we weren't there because we were sharing the Lord Jesus with somebody. And Cliff and I remember we pulled up to the job site, and Cliff looked at it, and I looked at it, and we go, "That's not really good. Wow, that's amazing that the floor is still up." Because we didn't have, did we, Cliff? And we both jumped out of the vehicle, threw our belts on, said, "We better get there kind of quick." And we ran, grabbed some 2x12s, ran underneath in the basement part. And as we were running, we were hearing this pop, 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 crack, pop. And that thing was coming down. Right? And we crammed them 2x4s up there. It's almost like, you know, we laughed afterwards because it's almost like the angels are sitting there like this. "The boys are here." I mean, it had to have been there for a half hour, hour, you know, they were sitting there not moving. And as soon as we got out of the car, we start hearing the pop crackle of the plywood and everything going down. And it's like, "Let's have some fun with the boys." And I remember on that job site, we were doing hand carts. Sometimes we were trying to stand on our hands. And if you ever have a tool belt on and you try to do that, it's amazing how much junk falls out. Yeah, all over the floor and everything, you know. And we're laughing and we're giggling. And for the most part, we can't remember building that church. It's like we were drunk in the Holy Ghost having such a good time. We don't know how it got done. We'd spend sometimes 3-4 hours a day fellowshipping with other people, witnessing and sharing with Julian Wolf and others, and we got, and somehow we got the work done.
I just want to plant the thought in it. What would it be like? Is it possible for you to go through life from now until Jesus comes, being intoxicated, being in the depth of his love, having your boat out in the deep water, not in the shallow waters of fear and anxiety and worry and frustration and bitterness and resentment? I'm telling you, Paul is saying, I'm praying for all the saints that they'd be able to comprehend this love. What would it be like going through life, even though you're having loved ones, you know, pass away and go home to Jesus? What would it be like, to, even though you got crisis on hand, just to be full of God's love? Because, you know, for those of us who have experienced, and most of you have, those moments when you're so full and experiencing his presence, it's just like nothing matters. You don't worry about your reputation. Just like when you're drunk on wine, you really, things don't matter. That's why you do weird things. That's why you walk down the street weird. I mean, you know, you just don't care. You laugh at the wrong appropriate times. You giggle. You're obnoxious. Do you realize a good spirit-filled, on fire, full of love Christian can be obnoxious? It's like they don't worry when everybody else is worrying. They're not wrapped up tight like everybody else. They got a smile on their face when they shouldn't. But man, what would it be like to get through life that way? And Paul is saying, I'm praying that you guys understand. Paul went through 5 whippings of having his back whipped 3 times. He hung his feet up in the air and took steel rods and beat every bone in his foot till it broke. Never supposed to walk again. Never supposed to function again. And Paul, that was it. He got stoned, and you know, and I don't mean like my friends. They were rocks. He got up and walked back into the city. He did all those things, and you think, man, he had experienced the healing power of Jesus. He had experienced the love of God to do all that stuff. Hallelujah. We were down at the cabin, and I was out back one morning, and there was a little stream there, and Lisa walked up, and she says, wow, where's all the fish? And earlier this spring, it was running, you know, 2-3 feet deep, and, you know, you couldn't see anything. Now it's calmed down, and you know, all the settlement's kind of in there, so it's a little, you know, dirty that way, but the water's clear. And I was just sitting on a bench reading the Word and enjoying myself, and I was looking, too. I said, yeah, I don't see any fish in there. And then God started ministering to me about what we've been talking about, and he just said, John, you know, let me give you a demonstration here this morning about your own perceptions. And in the next hour or so, an incredible experience of just him talking to me and walking through this. And by the end, let me just shorten it up. By the end of the hour, I looked out into the stream, and there was 16 fish right in front of me. 16 fish were right in about a 10-foot area right in front of me. By the way, Lisa went out the next morning and counted 50. And just when we first got there, she said, where are all the fish? And I said, I don't know. I must have got, you know, just not very many here. And they were there all the time. And then I got to look at it, and he just said to me, I said, son, do you realize how important your perception is? And I said, well, you've been teaching me this for years. He said, look, and so it's a beautiful rock wall right behind the cabin, and then it's just gorgeous, and it's just so peaceful. It's just incredible. And as I was looking at it, he says, what do you see? And I looked over in the background, and then he began to show me. He said, you can see whatever you want to see, whatever you choose to see. And I just want to tell you, what do you see when you look forward in life? When you lift up your eyes and look to your future, what do you see? When you look around the world, what do you see? When you look around the community, what do you see? And for some, you can see nothing but death. And I looked up, and there's pine beetles that have really taken out a lot of trees in that area. There's death there. And I looked down, and I won't go into all that, but you can imagine. I thought, man, you can see destruction. You can see little water bugs being eaten by fish. Just gone. If you're a water bug fan.
mean, you see the plants that are dying. You could see all those things, the blooms that have fallen off. You could see that. You could see the grass that is dying. You could see, you could see all that. I mean, and then we got, and the Father and I got to talking, and we got talking about miracles. Do you know the word miracle really means an inherent power within by nature? In other words, when God talks about his miraculous power, when God talks about miracles, it's really talking about something that has power within itself by nature that blooms. And you may not think that's significant, but I hope you do by the end of this message. What did Paul just say there in Ephesians? He says, these things that God's going to do exceedingly beyond anything you've ever imagined or thought by the power that works where? Within you. Within you. And by the way, that within doesn't mean it just starts in there. It means that's where it resides. That means that's where its birthing place was. That means that's its origin. The power that works mighty miracles in your life is inherent. In other words, it came with the package. In other words, it's natural. It's your power. Now, for a lot of people, it's like, ooh, John. You know, that's what God, Jesus, crucified. He says, me and my Father, we're one. And they said, man, you're blaspheming. He said, your Bible says ye are gods. You don't get upset. God, you derived your name. You derived your origin from the creator of all things. You derived your original being from God. Whether you acknowledge him or not. People sit there and I don't believe in God. And I thought, that don't matter. He's still your God. And he's secure with that. It's like when our children say, I hate you. Well, they hardly ever do that. I think they might have done it once, twice. Bam. We got that out. No, not really. But it's like when a little kid says, you're not my daddy no more. It's like, it's okay. You don't fall apart. You know the truth. God knows the truth that he's the father of all people. He made them all. He's not opposed with everybody getting up and saying, what was the thing back in the 60s and 70s in Time magazine? God is dead. That was a big deal. God is dead. The Time magazine says God is dead. Well, Time magazine says a lot of stuff. No, very little of it has anything to do with life or truth. The people got upset. Christians got upset. Is God really dead? I mean, come on. You think God's up there going, oh, my gosh. We get so tense, he doesn't get tense. Miracles. Let me tell you something about miracles. The miracles are things that have their power within them and bloom. And people say, I don't believe in miracles. I've never seen a miracle. And I want to say, you can look at that stream and see death, or you can look at that stream and see nothing but life. And as I begin to look around, I go, and God said, look around, see the life. And I got to looking around, and I go, oh my gosh. Yeah, there's a pine beetle taking a few trees out, but all the way down this rock is probably 60, 80 feet tall back there, and it has a crack, and all the way down this crack, there's trees growing out. And some of these trees have gotten that big or that big, and then I looked at one, and I wanted to crawl over there and take a picture, but I didn't get it done, and I was like, I don't know, I'll have to get one of the monkeys, my nephews or my sons or somebody crawl up the rock and take a close-up. But there's this little bitty tree right in the middle of the rock, and I can't see any crack around. It's like it just came out of the rock, and I'm sure there must have been something. There must have been a slight little crack there. But I thought, man, I planted pine trees in beautiful soil and fertilized and watered, and they go, pfft. And here's this little tree that I don't understand. And it's sitting there growing and got life to it. And I said, and God just says, it's whatever you want to see. And we walked into the Norbeck Center there, and they had this tree cut down, sliced, and it said, you birthed 1597. They counted the rings back, and they counted that thing clear back, and it died in 1927 by insects. This thing is that big around, and some itty-bitty insects went in and bit it until it died. That's like death by paper cut. Huh?
I mean, those little insects are just that big. Here's this great big tree. Been around for 300 years. Survived famine, survived fires, survived all the things that took place. And then all of a sudden, these little bitty bugs come up and kill it. And you can go, oh, death. The whole world's full of death. Our future's bad. Everything's done. People are all going crazy. Oh, the world is, you know, da-da-da-da. You know what I mean? You can watch the news and it's just nothing but bad, bad, bad. Or you can look and say, 300 years that tree lived. 300 years it survived and saw how many generations go by. How many kids carved their initials on that tree? How many critters lived in it? Life, life. And it's like, what do you want to focus in on? Well, here's what the Lord kept saying. He said, son, life is totally determined on your perceptions. Your whole life is going to be based on your perceptions. If you get up in the morning and look and just say, there's just death everywhere, people are dying, there's cancer, there's heart attacks, there's car wrecks and all that, and there's money problems and there's financial problems and there's relationship problems, and the gear God just talking about it makes me depressed. You can wake up and just feel that in the morning, can't you? How many of you wake up in the morning and just feel like a cloud is all over you? You know, you got to bust through that thing, just of all the things that might take place. Or you can get up in the morning and say, man, there is such an... Listen, in the creation that God created that we call nature, which really means, if you go back in the how the words came about, it was saying the nature of God created this. That's how we got the word nature. It was the idea that God himself revealed himself. And that's what the Bible says. Paul says that in Romans, first chapter. He said, if you want to know what God is like, look at his creation. And if you look at his creation, you can see how much death, how many animals bite each other and kill each other and eat each other. And by the way, there's a mountain lion that goes by our cabin about every, you know, quite often at 10 o'clock, because there's a little camera that takes pictures sometimes, and he comes by. And Lisa made me go out at 10 o'clock. Actually, I made her. She goes, what time is it? I said, about 10. Isn't that when the lion comes out? I said, yeah, you'll be fine. Oh, I harassed her, and she, you know, and then I went out the second night, and I'm telling you, I got that flashlight. And I'm thinking, what do I do if I see two little eyes looking at me? Run, nothing, because I had a nightmare for 5 years of my life, a reoccurring nightmare that I'm running to my grandparents' house, and as soon as I get to the screen door, the Black Panther jumps, and I can't get the dang door open. That's one of my reoccurring dreams. I don't know what that means, but I thought about it on this because I was at the screen door. What are your perception? Are you just out there being vulnerable? Or are you out there going to experience life? What's your perception? See, to get into the depths of God's love, the practical aspect of it means, what do you perceive it to be? And do you perceive that you can have it? And if you perceive that it's yours and comprehend it, it's yours. If you say, oh, it's just so hard, I can't get it, then guess what? You don't have it. It's not that it's not there. You just don't have it because you don't comprehend it. You don't grab hold of it for yourself and say, oh, I embrace this. I'm going to be like that little pine tree where there's not a blade of anything around, just a rock and no dirt and nothing. And I'm going to grow because I got it in me to grow. And you say, oh, man, my family's in trouble and this is in trouble and my kids are in trouble and everything's going down. And you can either just collapse or you can say, this is the time for a miracle. And a miracle is the power that works mightily within me. Do you know something about miracles that most people believe? They believe that if you can explain a miracle, well, let's put it this way. Miracles are unexplainable. A lot of people, their definition is, a miracle is something that can't be explained. So if it can be explained, it's not a miracle anymore. Do you realize that you're just cutting a lot of miracles out? If you want to see miracles every day, you got to rewrite some of your definitions. And one of those definitions you got to rewrite is that miracles can be explained. And you say, well,
I don't know if I buy that. Well, let me just go to the Word. Mark 4, Jesus said, this is the way the whole kingdom works. This is the way the whole thing works. You plant a little seed in the dirt, and it grows up, and it sinks down roots, and it grows up the blade, and it finally brings out a harvest, and it reproduces itself some 30, some 40, some 60, some 100 times more than what you planted. And then he said, and he took his disciples, and he said, they came to him and said, what the heck did that mean? And he goes, to you I'm going to explain. He explained the whole process of the miraculous world, of God's world, to God's kingdom, and he explained it in a parable, and it was a mystery to everybody else. It was a secret to everybody else. They didn't understand. But to his disciples, they came and asked him, he said, let me explain so miracles can be explained. See, I have this philosophy. Well, let's don't go there. You know, another thing that people believe is that miracles have to violate God's nature or nature. It goes, you know, it's like the sun stops and everything stops or whatever, you know. Let's take walking on the water. How does that work? Can you explain it? I hope somebody can. I'm going to Jesus saying, I want to know. I want to know. Before I die, I want to know. I want to know how you walk on water. And I mentioned it because we were walking on this path behind this dam, and then you looked over, and here's this almost looks like a putting green down there below. Man, I thought, whew, look at that putting green. And then my contacts are kind of, you know, I can't hardly see a thing with them. But I can read the odometer on my bike, so I wear them. But so finally I looked and go, that ain't no putting green. That's a slime field, man. That was like a pond that was just green and gook. You know what I mean? Whew. I thought, man, if I would have stepped down there. Misperception. And the more I looked at it, I thought, man, that's pretty, maybe it's heavy enough to walk on. Maybe enough of that gooey stuff is there, I could walk on water. Because see, I got it in my heart. I want to know how Jesus walked in the water. He said, why? He's just God. That's another one of the misconceptions, is that a miracle is just a sovereign move of God. No, it's not. No, it's not. God's moved all he's moved, going to move. He sat down. He's finished. You can't get God to do a sovereign move because he sat down waiting. And by the way, the word miracle means a power within. Not a power from without. And all people, and Lisa, and she saw me looking at the water, and I said something about walking on water. She says, I just can't go there with you. And she wasn't talking about going down there and stepping in it. She's talking about this concept I have that walking on the water can be explained, and walking on the water does not break natural law. And I'll just throw this out one more time. Jesus said, the Bible says that he emptied himself of all deity and walked as a man. So it tells me when he walked in the water, he walked as a man. That means a man knew how to walk on water. Peter got out of the boat and he walked on the water and he was nothing but a man. And he would have kept walking on the water if he hadn't looked at the wind. Now I know this much. Whether it's windy or not windy, you can't walk on water. Huh? It was not an issue. Was it? Get the calmest day in your life and try to walk on water. And so, but Peter's walking on the water and all of a sudden he goes, ah, it's windy. Had nothing to do with it or did it. Because the moment he looked, the moment he sank. Please remember that. And then another misconception about miracles are that they're exceptions. They're rare.
And as I looked at that little stream, I go, no, no, perception wrong. Turn it. Turn the boat, man. Turn it. Miracles are not the exception. Miracles are happening all the time. And this one I easily can comprehend now because just studying science just tells me, man, there are 100,000 different things happening in every cell in your body, which is about 3 trillion cells in your body right now. 100,000 things happening perfectly every second that you breathe. It's a miracle, 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 miracle. I mean, and all of a sudden you get a cold and you go, I don't believe in miracles because I can't get over this cold. I can't even get rid of a headache. How am I going to get rid of cancer? That's stupid. I didn't mean to say that. I meant to say it like this. Idiot. Has nothing to do with it. There's just miracles happening every day. Every day in every realm. And if you look around, it's just over and over and over and over. Everything's a miracle. Dear God, it's a miracle. There's the power of the seed within, bringing the grass, the flowers. We studied the flowers up there. We looked at all that. There's just life goes on, life goes on. And even though you have friends that die, you have things that collapse, you have things in your life. Guess what? You and I, all this whole congregation someday is going to be gone if Jesus tarries. But there's going to be life going on here. Hallelujah. Your grandchildren. And great-grandchildren are going to have to live in their life. And you can either see it as, oh, my, or you can say, oh, my. But your perception makes all the difference in the world of what's going to happen. Because the Bible says, be it done to you according to the way you perceive it. And guess what? If miracles are real rare, you're going to look to think that only you can get one or two in your lifetime. If you think miracles are abundance, you're going to think you can get 100 of them every day. Guess who's going to get more? He was looking for one or two. He's looking for 1,000. And the Bible says this, that your faith, everything you're believing on becomes effective when you start acknowledging it. As you start acknowledging how many miracles are happening in your life, out of your inward belly, things that are happening inside of you, every day miracles are happening. The more you acknowledge it, the more it functions. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You can literally get to where you're so intoxicated in this understanding that things that come slamming against you just bounce off. Don't mean hardly a thing to you. Hallelujah. John 15. You know, I preached a little hard out for 40 minutes just to get to my point. But it's a good point. Hallelujah. Say it's a good point, Pastor. You haven't heard it yet, so you're saying that by faith. John 15. Have you ever heard of the word whatever? How many ways can you say whatever? Whatever. Whatever is a powerful word, you know, especially when it's whispered. Whatever. Whatever. Ah, whatever. Well, let's read John 15. Let me look at where I should start here. Wherever. Let's go to verse 4. Abide in me, Abide in me, and I in you, as a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. We're not talking about you coming up with your own thing. We're talking about when you abide in God, you have this inherent power miracle inside of you. I am the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Now, sometimes all we do is look at that do nothing thing instead of the part that says you can bear much fruit. Colt, you can bear a lot of fruit in your lifetime. A lot of fruit. You've had some really good, neat things happen already. You got so much more. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up, and they gather him up and cast him in the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever. Whatever you want, you wish, and it'll be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. Just as the Father has loved me, I also love you. Abide in my love. Does that sound anything like get your boat off of the dock and get it out in the deep? Abide in the love, get into the deep. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and I abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you that your joy may be full, that I have spoken to you that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be made full. Whatever. Nice sermon. Whatever. It was a good service. Yeah, whatever. Or is it like this? Jesus said, hey, get your boat out into the depths of my love and stay there. And whatever you ask, it'll be given to you. Yeah, okay, thanks, Lord, whatever. I mean, we can blow it off, can't we? Huh? We can just blow it off what he said. Yeah, whatever. Church service is over. That was good. Let's go back to our normal gripe, complain, gloom and doom, poor me. Wish I could have some fun. Think I'll go get you. You know, oh, what the heck. Whatever. You want to discuss me about me? Is I have a very addictive personality. If I like something, I really like it. And I want it. And my grandfather was an alcoholic. He was a mean alcoholic. I loved him. And I love him today. Because he's home in heaven rooting me on. I tell you, there's so many times I'm laying on my back looking up over in some other country or whatever else, and I literally see a well up in heaven, and I see two faces come over the well and look down, and it's my two grandfathers. When Myrna died, I told her, she'd heard this story enough, and I told Myrna right before she died, I looked up, and you know, she was out of it. Man, she was hardly communicating. She was going into that. She hadn't gotten into the death rattle, but she was not communicating. She was not, and I was sitting there, holding her hand about a day before she died, and I just said, Myrna, greet my grandparents for me, because she'd heard this from me so many times. Because my two grandfathers, one of them served the Lord all the days of his life, was a pastor and all that, never drank, chewed, never had. He chewed once, he said. He found something in the bottom of the pot. He thought it was a chunk of meat, and it was a hunk of, and he chewed. Not very long. But anyway, so that's that guy, and then there's my other grandfather, notorious, crazy, wild living guy in the Black Hills. His name was Drake, and they called him Ducky, and I could go to Marty and I, we could go to a dead and say, well, our grandfather's Ducky, and they go, ooh, yes, your grandfather, who could I tell you stories? You know, and this guy was lively and colorful, but he was a mean drunk, and he didn't get saved until 2 years before he passed away. I was a junior in high school when he passed away. And there's so many times I'm over there and I'm experiencing this crazy stuff, you know, seeing miracles and seeing people saved and just going through. And I'll look up and there are the both of them, just two totally different characters. And they walk over together in heaven. And every once in a while they look down and go, they look at each other and go, that's our boy. That's the combination of us. Go, John, go. And then they walk off. And I told that to Myrna and I said, greet my parents, my grandparents. And I'll never forget, she came up out of the darkness of dying. She was not moving her right hand at all at that point. And I was thinking, I'm a pastor ministering to her. And all of a sudden, she reached up and she grabbed my face, Ed, just like this. And she grabbed me, and her other hand came up. And she looked right at me. And it, I swear, here I was just being the strong pastor, you know, being with somebody's going. And she reached up, grabbed me, and I mean, I felt it. I feel it now. I felt all over, and she looked me right in the eye, and her eyes just got clear from being all that cloudy stuff, just got clear, and said, he loves you so much. And she's talking about Jesus. He loves you so much. And she sat there for about 3 minutes and just ministered to my heart about God's love for me. I broke down. I broke down. Now, I kept my composure in the hospital. I walked out of there and I go, what did I do? I looked at the eyes of Jesus in her eyes
when you read these pictures, you know, we got that book in the back about the little girl that paints, and you read about Colton, you know, and he died. Everybody that's ever seen Jesus says, you look in his eyes like pools of living water and whatever else. And that's what I saw in Myrna's eyes. And it was Jesus looking right at me. He said, he loves you. And the feeling I felt, I mean, I felt it. It just started buzzing me all over. It gave me a buzz. I was just going to say, I would drink for the buzz. I like the buzz. I like the feeling. And, man, I was feeling it all over. And, man, I got out of the hospital. I just finally, you know, I just kind of got out, sat down in my car, and just fell apart. Just sat there and sobbed and weeped and weeped. I just seen Jesus. I just felt Jesus. He just touched my face. He touched me. Hallelujah. I was there to minister, and he ministered to me. I just sat there and wept and wept. I felt the love of God. I felt so swallowed up in him. Hallelujah. And you know, Jesus actually wants us to dwell there. He said, abide in this. Abide in this. Now, if you don't perceive that's possible, you won't even attempt it, will you? And maybe today there's nothing more going to happen than just say, you think? I don't know. But that might be enough. Whatever. And you know what I see with this whatever word? Jesus said, whatever you ask, it'll be granted to you. Whatever. And I got to think about it. He's blowing it off. He's saying, if you abide in me, ask whatever. But keep your focus on me. Keep your focus on my love. Don't get your focus on the whatever. Blow it off. It's not that big a deal. What's the big deal is abiding in his love. What the big deal is swimming, getting your boat out there in that love. Because when you're out there, you can ask whatever. But you know what we do? We pick one whatever. Oh, God, heal. Oh, God, deliver. Oh, God, finance, whatever it is. And we got our eyes on that thing. Oh, come on. Oh, come on. Oh, come on. We got our eyes on the whatever. But he's saying, whatever. Get it off of that. Get it onto me. Get it onto my love. Because when you're abiding in my love, the whatever's a whatever. It's nothing. It's a piece of cake. It's natural. Those kind of miracles are natural. They come right out of the belly. Hallelujah. Your healing, your deliverance, your freedom from fear, your freedom from anxiety. But if you get your eye on that, it's going to be like Peter getting his eye on the wind and sinking again. When he kept his eyes on Jesus, he walked on water. This is a very practical, pragmatic message, not a theory. And the more you get your eyes on Jesus and realize, then you can say, whatever I ask, I get, so I'm just going to ask. Would you stand with me, please? Can you say this with me? Whatever. You know how we make a mountain out of some of the things we're asking for? They're so big, they're so gigantic, it would take such a miracle. God would have to break all the laws of nature. God would have to make a sovereign move to do it. It's really rare. Or we can look at this and just say, whatever. It's a piece of cake. Have you got a big thing in your life? Today might be a good day. I don't know. Wasn't there a movie where you took a gun and you shot something and it made it itty bitty small? Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. Was that it? Good picture. Take your shrinking gun and shoot the whatever you got in your life that seems so unsurmountable. Maybe it's you. Maybe you want to be somebody you're not acting like. Maybe you want to be totally different than you've ever been before. Maybe you want to get your boat off the dock because you really aren't you till you get out in the deep. And by the way, those ropes that tie your boat to the dock of fear and anxiety, guilt and shame, by the way, you can be clear out in the deep, and the moment you think about those things, you're back at the dock. You don't even get the trip back in. That's how fast you can tie yourself back up. But you can get right back out in the deep with just saying, whatever.
My Jesus loves me. I have no guilt, no shame of asking him for a new job, a new attitude, a new perception. Because it's whatever. He just said whatever. Whatever he asked. Well, you think I could ask? Whatever. You think it'd be okay? Whatever. I don't care. He don't care. You shouldn't care. Just ask. But stay abiding in his love. Anybody get anything out of this today? It's doable. And it shouldn't be rare. Because you got it inside you to do it. You don't even have to get it. God to move. You don't have. He's already moved. All you got to do is what? Whatever. Believe it. Come on. Get a little bit of attitude before we leave. Come on. Let's see some attitude. You've been sleeping on me. Whatever. Been dropping off like this the whole time. A lot of you. Just, if you can do that, not be embarrassed. Some of you are snoring. Not embarrassed, then at least get a little bit of an attitude. Put your hand on your hip. Get some of that new jersey. Whatever. Whatever. Let's hear some whatevers. Whatever. Whatever. Yeah, whatever. I guess I'll see you next week. Whatever.